Good morning, Broadway. It is my joy to welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. Today we say goodbye for now to our two Duke interns, Bria and Kiana. It's been a blessing to have them as part of our community virtually this summer, and we wish them both well as they relocate to Durham, North Carolina this week. I would also like to thank Vickie, Gisele, Alicia, Karen, and Jim for all of their good work each week preparing our online worship service. Let us now worship our great God together.
Let us join together in the call to worship found in the United Methodist hymnal number 512, Stand By Me, by Charles Albert Tindley. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. Lord, hear my cry and rescue me. When the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea, God who rules wind and water, stand by me. God stands with you in bright sunshine and deepest storm. God gently guides us to safety and peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.
As we light our candles this morning, let's think about the ways God has lit candles of light in the chaos of the summer. I wonder where God has shown up, bringing light in the past couple months, this week, and this morning. As we think about the light in our lives, or possible darkness, let's come together and sing Just As I Am with Gisele as she sings the opening hymn.
Lord, you showed favor to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people. You pardoned all their sin. You withdrew all your wrath. You turned from your hot anger. Restore us again, O God of our salvation, and put away your indignation toward us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation.
The glory of
Let me hear that God will speak, for the Lord will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to the Lord in their hearts. Surely salvation is at hand for those who fear the Lord, that glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. The Lord will give what is good, and your land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before the Lord and make God's footsteps a way.
And now it's time for the lesson from the contemporary church, because God didn't stop speaking to us when the book went to press.
Good morning, Broadway. It's been such an incredible summer being able to work with this team and getting to know so many of you. The Broadway community is truly a special bunch of people that are dedicated to being a part of God's work in the world through various avenues. I just wanted to highlight what a great experience being a part of the Pub Theology group on Tuesdays has been this summer. While the attendees varied, the conversations were always engaging and informative in so many ways. This group showcased the amazing kind of conversations that can be opened through disagreement and through the effort to think about how we can play a part in the local and national politics that guide our society. Through this group, I've been encouraged to embrace my own civic duties and to be more informed about my local governments in order to support policies that contribute to the thriving and the flourishing of everyone in my own community. This group has made me realize that the work that we do for the kingdom of God isn't always separate from the work of governmental agencies. And so for this group and for the many conversations that Kiana and I have had this summer with several of you, I am so thankful. This summer has left me with a more expansive view of how ministry and discipleship can take on very non-traditional and externally impactful practices. God has moved through the constant encouragement of Miss Vickie Daniel, the dedicated work of Jim Fore, the meaningful conversations had by Jada and Jalen, and the roving listeners, through the impassioned leadership of Pastor Arron and Reverend Alicia, through the guidance and support of Melissa Spaz, and in the many eye-opening conversations had with several dedicated members of the Broadway community. I leave this internship with hope and greatly encouraged that the Holy Spirit moves vivaciously through the beautiful hues of difference that many would say are a barrier to unity. The beauty in Broadway is found in its celebration of difference and the dedication to let the joy, the justice, and the generosity of Jesus be its message to the world. Thanks be to God for this witness. I'll miss y'all, and I can't wait to make my way to Indy one of these days. See ya.
Hi, Broadway. It's so sad to think that Bria and I are wrapping up our time with you all. And I could say a reflection on each and every one of you and the things that we've learned and just the fun times and really life-giving times that Bria and I have had with so many of you. But specifically, I want to reflect on how I learned this summer that ministry can be fun. And that's something that I talked with Pastor Mike about. It's something that I talked with our lovely supervisor, Melissa Spaz, about. And I think for me, it really marked this transition of seeing ministry as, and the church as this thing, like we are called into the world and we are supposed to go into these places that need help and I hate to say it, but I kind of had this mentality of like problem solving, and the church is supposed to make the world better and fix things. And because of that, it held a lot of weight in my mind. And I think that it's still true that the church is still called to make things more flourishing and more life-giving. But my mindset has kind of changed about how that happens. And things, talking with Pastor Mike and Melissa and Pastor Arron, realizing that our job as the church and people in the church is not to fix things or fix people, but we get to worship God and we get to call out what God wants and what God sees. And that means not seeing people or communities as problems. It's seeing those things and people as people with treasure and gifts and people that can contribute. It's looking at places in the world that some consider dark and messy or confusing, and calling out what God sees. And God sees abundance, and God sees treasure there. And that makes ministry and church work fun, because it's not about us struggling to figure out if we can do enough. It's us coming to the table and valuing other people and reminding them through our words and actions that they matter and that God sees them, that God wants them in God's family, and we want them in our family, and two, getting away from the language of us and them. And yeah, so really just a more life-giving approach to ministry. And I don't think I would have had that if I was not at Broadway this summer. And I think this experience will impact every sort of ministry or pastoral care that I do going forward. And I think this is exactly where the Lord wanted me placed, because in valuing people, that's how we get to be part of God's healing in the world. So thank you so much to everyone who has been a part of this process and has given and poured into Bria and I. We really appreciate you, and we hold you in God's peace as we continue.
Matthew chapter 14, 22-33. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountains by himself to pray. When the evening came, he was there alone, but by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the winds against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered them, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "Do you have little faith? Why do you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Holy words, holy wisdom.
Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children. Wait in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. See that host all dressed in white. God's gonna trouble the water. The leader looks like an Israelite. God's gonna trouble the water. Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children, wait in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. See that band all dressed in red? God's gonna trouble the water. Looks like the band that Moses led. God's gonna trouble the water. Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children. Wait in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. If you don't believe I've been redeemed, God's gonna trouble the water. Just follow me down to Jordan Stream. God's gonna trouble the water. Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children. Wait in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. God's gonna trouble the water. God's gonna trouble the water.
Barbara Brown Taylor tells a story from the Zen Buddhist tradition about the disciple who thought he would improve his chances of enlightenment by seeking it all on his own. So he bid farewell to his brothers in the monastery, took the ferry across the river, and went to live in a cave high in the hills all by himself. There he meditated for 25 years. At the end of that time, he emerged from the cave, stretched his arms high above his head like a man waking up from a long sleep, and he made his way down to the river. Without even pausing to test the temperature first, he stepped out on the water and proceeded to walk across it toward the monastery that he had left a quarter of a century before. Two monks were there doing their laundry that same morning, and they saw him coming across the water. "Who is that?" one of them asked. The other replied, "That is the old man who has spent 25 years meditating in a cave. Now look at him. He can walk on water." "What a pity," the first monk said. "The ferry only costs a quarter." Well, in our gospel reading from Matthew, we heard another story of a familiar attempt to walk on water that Peter made on the Sea of Galilee. I doubt if it had ever occurred to Peter to try to walk on water before, and it obviously did not occur to the disciples to do it either, since they all stayed put in the boat and kept rowing and bailing. But when Peter saw the ghost-like Jesus on the water, he cried out over the howling winds, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And to that, Jesus, although apparently very near the boat, since Peter could hear his cry over the waves and the wind, and I'm sure somewhat smirkingly, and perhaps with a little head shake, he responded, "Come." Well, not surprisingly, Peter got the same result I got every single time when I was a child and I tried to run across the top of the water in a swimming pool. Most sermons I've heard on this passage point to this being a story of faith, or better yet, a lack of faith demonstrated by Peter. We preacher types like to use Peter's apparent lack of faith to tell you that you just need to have complete faith in Jesus, to just keep your eyes fixed firmly upon him, and then you too can venture out of the boat, even in the biggest storms of your life, because after all, if you have faith, then anything is possible. Well, no matter what state of faith or faithlessness you find yourself in at this moment, I would not suggest you trying to walk on water. But maybe this story isn't really about Peter's faith, but perhaps it is really about his doubts about Jesus. Notice that Peter says, what Peter says to Jesus right after Jesus calms the disciples' initial fear of seeing his ghost-like presence with the words, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter says, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." If it is you, if you are Jesus, if you are the Messiah who has come to save us, if you are the Son of God, if it is you. In other words, Peter is doubting Jesus is who Jesus says he is. So much so, in fact, that he demands that Jesus prove it. These same words may sound familiar from when the devil tempted Jesus in the wilderness, saying, "If you are the Son of God, then do this or do that." Peter is putting Jesus to the test. And then there is also, I think, a healthy dose of arrogance and self-promotion in Peter's request as well. Jesus is coming to them on the water. He will arrive at the boat very, very soon. But Peter, and only Peter, wants to prove that he is special, that he's a big shot. He wants to be the hero of the story and show the other disciples that just for him, Jesus will grant an exemption from the laws of nature. But Jesus, like the good teacher that he was, instantaneously realized this was a teaching moment for Peter and for us. So he said, "Come," to Peter. And then as Peter steps off of the boat into the waves, Jesus climbs into the boat, and quickly Peter begins to sink. So he cries out to Jesus, "Lord, save me." In this simple declaration, it's made clear that the lesson had been learned. Jesus is the Lord, and he has come to save us. So Jesus reaches out his hand to Peter and pulls him back into the boat, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" Now, Peter may have sank because he possessed weak faith, as it is often preached. Or he may have sank because he wanted to put Jesus to the test and be a big shot. But either way, one thing is clear. The miracle came when Jesus and all of the disciples were back in the same boat together. It was then that the wind ceased. And the disciples did what came naturally as a response. They worshiped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." Jesus wants to be with us. Jesus wants to calm the storms of our lives, but Jesus prefers to do it when we do it together, when we do it in a community where nobody has to be a superstar and do it on their own, and nobody has to try to impress. The storms of life, either internal or external, cannot be calmed alone, whether we are isolated like the monk in the cave or trying to grandstand like Peter to get Jesus's attention. It is in all of the messiness of living in community where we encounter Jesus and his salvation. Jesus does not need us to be a hero. We don't need to do spectacular feats like walking on water. We need to simply get in the boat with our neighbors, steer toward the waves, let the wind of the Holy Spirit do its work to break down the walls that bind and divide us, for you, for others, and for the community who is traveling with us. Together, we can trust the wind of the Spirit cold and trembling as our hands may be. Thanks be to God. Amen.
As we go to God in prayer today, we lift up a few prayer requests and praises. We ask for protection for our teachers, staff, and students as they return to schools. We pray for special healing for Dr. Walt Tinsley as he recovers from a fall. We pray for all of the families affected by the explosion in Beirut this week. We celebrate the marriage of Wolf von Roos on August the 1st. We celebrate the completion of the youth roving program this summer with their amazing leaders, Jalen and Jada Ford. With these and other concerns, let us pray. Gracious God, we lift up to you the prayers and the praises that have been brought forward this week. We have confidence that when we bring these petitions to you, that you will hear us because you are a God who hears. These voices cry out to you for guidance, for sustenance, for nurture, and for peace. We also sing your praises for the many ways you have been present with us through times of sorrow and times of joy. You have instilled within us a spirit of resilience, patience, action, and grit. We hold on to your command to take heart because it is you that we see. We shall not be afraid of the fierce winds that blow around us, for the peace that you bring quiets them. Allow us to find a route to the quiet amidst the chaos, so that when we are called back to enter back into the chaos, we may be refilled and replenished. As we who are called to heal, to teach, to liberate, to provide food and other supplies, to inform and empower, to enact justice, to care for others, and to care for ourselves, enter into our spaces and places of being. Strengthen us, encourage us, and fill us up with the power of the Holy Spirit that protects, enlivens, and brings truth. Allow us to be change agents that help to bring a healing to this land and to this world. And allow us to embrace our own humanity so that we never forget that we cannot do this without you, and we cannot do this without each other. Thanks be to God. Amen.
to the alley. Take me to the afflicted ones. Take me to the lonely ones that somehow lost their way. Let them hear me say,
let us together affirm our mission. As followers of Jesus Christ, responding to God's love, our mission as the people of Broadway Church is to be a multicultural Christian community that in its ministry seeks, welcomes, and values all people.
Go now, trusting in Christ's very spirit, a mighty wind leading us into beautiful faces and threatening waves, to live for the good of the world and as a sign of our love for one another. Go in peace. Amen.